Divine Truth Assistance Group. Group assistance sessions putting principles of divine truth into action. This recording is from the Developing My Loving Self group and is part of an Education in Love series. In the Creation of My Facade presentation, Jesus explains how the choice to refuse to feel terror and to be emotionally overwhelmed by pain creates a facade that causes more sin and pain. Where this emotional refusal came from, and the techniques that we develop, maintain, and use to deny pain. Recorded on the 21st of May 2016 in Noosaville, Queensland, Australia.
All right. Now, I would say that every talk that we've developed in this in all of these sessions are pretty important, but this one's a fairly important one in understanding yourself. So let's examine it. It's the title of this talk is The Creation of My Facade. And obviously we're going to examine some of the primary reasons or primary methods we've used to create our facade. Now, before I do begin with the talk proper, there the copying of the drives on the right-hand side are new drives that you want me to copy, and on the left-hand side at the back are the drives I've already copied. Is that all right? So what I've done is I've moved many of the drives from the left-hand side to the right-hand side, and the ones that are on the left-hand side, unless people have put extra there, they should be already done. You know the ones that are not already done, you better put them on the right-hand side for me. Okay? And Nina, you would like to ask, just Mike. Yeah, that's fine. We need to.
You copied and updated my drive last time. I'm just wondering if it's easy for you just to slide over the groups that have just happened 6 weeks ago.
It only takes an hour or so.
Great. Thank you.
Yep. So I did five drives last night. So. Okay. All right. So the creation of my facade. Ha! Let's enjoy the process of this examining our facade. Yeah. Okay. Now, probably what we need to do first is just examine some things that we were taught. So the main point I'd like to cover with you is really I was taught to fear my pain. Every person on this planet has been taught this thing. I've yet to see a person who came from this planet for many hundreds of years who hasn't been taught this. Okay, so I was taught to fear my pain. It is natural for a child to experience its own pain without fear. It's natural. Remember, I just gave the example just before of a child learning to walk, falls down, hurts itself, cries, releases the pain, and does it fear its pain? No, it gets straight back up and tries again. As if it has no fear, and it doesn't, because it released it. It released its pain, so therefore there is no fear. Does that make sense? We were all taught, instead of doing that, we were all taught to suppress our pain. We were all taught to close down. Now, there were two mechanisms by which we were taught to close down. The first mechanism is my parents. And let's replace for parents, family of origin. If you know they weren't your parents, they might have been adoptive parents or whatever. My parents' example. Most of you, even now, could examine your parents if they're still alive. You could examine your parents and go, "Yep, they're still doing the same thing they did when I was a child," and that is, they fear their own pain. And they control it. using all sorts of techniques. That's what they do. They fear it and then they control it. And they'll use anything to do it. They'll use other people, their own children. They'll use substances. They'll use activity and all forms of addictions in order to continue doing this. And that's the example you grew up with. Now, remember from the age of, you know, when you were first conceived, right the way through to the age of 7 or 8, you're not even aware that a lot of this teaching is actually happening. You're just absorbing it. You're absorbing the example without being aware that you're being taught something. You're actually being brainwashed, ironically. Isn't that interesting? Like, people accuse me of brainwashing people, but I'm trying to unbrainwash you. You've been taught by example, firstly, that you must fear your pain. You can't experience it. Now, there are only a few occasions in your entire life where your parents allowed you to feel your pain without them being afraid of it. Right? And for most people, that was when you learnt to walk, for example, when you learnt to crawl, just some basic mobility things. Most parents have pride in those events. And so they allowed you to go through the experience without too much of their trauma being projected upon you. But that's not the case with the majority of your experiences. The majority of your experiences, you were actually, so your parents decided, because they were already doing this through their own example, suppressing their own pain, suppressing their own, they had a terrible fear of pain, they're trying to suppress their own pain. Now, on top of that, they fear and control your pain. It's a terrible thing to do that to a child, because you basically teach the child that it cannot cope with its own pain. Not only that, as parents, we are willing to do some quite excessive and even abusive things to children in order to suppress our own fear of what they might do. So the average child has been hit by their parent, which, if it happened to an adult, would be called assault. So the average child has been assaulted by their parents physically. And definitely most parents finish up verbally abusing their children at some point. And on top of that, they use manipulative tools to control your pain and their own. They use manipulative tools like bribes, you know, lollies, sweets, ice cream, and other manipulative tools in the negative, like restriction from other people, manipulative tools to manipulate your expression, your feeling of pain. So I'm not talking here just about the pain they cause you by their treatment of you. I'm talking here about the pain that they wish you to store inside of yourself, to do exactly what they want you to do with your pain, because that's what they do with theirs. Right? And none of you have been exempt from this, even though you might at times wish to believe you have been. Now, can you see it's not a very good start, is it? If we're taught that right from a young age, it's not a very good start to us thinking that we can be comfortable with experiencing pain. So already, now, as a young child, we have a whole layer of false beliefs about our pain that we now believe are loving ways to treat our pain, all being established. There's just that layer on top, the layer of fear and false definitions of love now over to the top of the pain, just from what we've been taught. Now, it is very difficult for a person who is living at home with a group of people who are teaching these particular things through their own example and through their treatment of the child to actually break away from that kind of thinking while you're still living with them. Can you see that? Very difficult. In fact, if you did attempt to break away from this kind of treatment as a child, it's highly likely you would have experienced more pain, more violence, more abuse, whether it be emotional or physical. Because any person who thwarts a parent in such a substantial way generally gets punished further. So that's not a very good start. So that's our first problem. Our first problem is we've been taught to fear our pain. This is why many of you are terrified of pain, Because firstly, you've been taught to be terrified of your pain, and everyone you grew up around was terrified of theirs. And they taught you how to be terrified of yours. It's not a natural condition. This is something we need to understand. It's not a natural condition. It is a condition that has been taught to us. We've learnt it over many years, starting in our early childhood, right the way through to the time that we've left home. We've been taught it. Now, that's by our parents. We've also been taught it by society. Right? We've also been taught that by society that this is the way we address pain. In fact, we've been taught by society that this is the loving way to address pain. You make it go away for people. That's what you do. If you love them, you make their pain go away. That's what you do. You suppress it. You use pills, tablets to suppress it if you can. And if that doesn't work, then you do everything you possibly can to suppress it using other techniques, emotional, drugs, alcohol, food, whatever you can. You use whatever you can to avoid the pain of experiencing specific emotions. That's what you do. And we've all been taught it. Big problem, huh? Yeah. So now we've had established all of these false beliefs about what love would do with regard to pain, all established and strictly enforced. And I must say, in most cases, violently enforced. So it's pretty harsh on the child, isn't it, for that to occur. So give yourself a break about your facade. You've been treated badly, even if people didn't know what they were doing at the time. Okay. What's the next thing? The next thing that happened which is probably a pretty understandable thing if you think about it, I choose to let's say, fear pain. So my parents have done this stuff and the society's done this stuff, and now it's become such a learned behavior in myself that I even think it's the right thing to do. That this is the way you live your life. You avoid pain, You fear pain and you avoid it at all costs. And you do anything, anything to avoid it. And if that means hurting somebody else, you hurt them. If that means attacking someone else, abusing someone else, that's what you do. If that means eating too much or drinking too much, or you do whatever is needed to avoid your pain. Pain is something that we just cannot experience. Nobody should have to experience it, and we all need to do as much as we possibly can to avoid it. And we even create a whole medical industry which is all about trying to avoid it, called pharmaceuticals. It's all trying to avoid pain. It's all about the avoidance of pain. Billions of dollars industries all created just to avoid pain. And that's the society we live in. It's a pity you can't have a pill to help you feel pain. Nobody's come up with one of those yet. Yeah, if you had a pill to feel emotional pain, that would be fantastic, but no one's thought of that. So can you see we haven't had a very good start? Isn't that true? Haven't had a good start. You can see it's quite difficult. You can see what's going on. And this is the reason why we finish up establishing what I would classify as a global emotion. A global emotion of terror relating to the experience of emotional pain. In fact, we all prefer to feel physical pain more than we prefer to feel emotional pain. Many of you have even said that in your past, if you think about it. I'd much rather have my leg cut off than feel this. You know? That's feeling emotional pain, we're just terrified of it. We have a global terror associated with it. So now we have this, a global emotional refusal of pain, a refusal of the feeling of terror. It's now been firmly established inside of us from a very young age. We've been manipulated, controlled, bribed, and forced through violent or abuse to have this opinion that we now protect with our life, because we are so dedicated to the concept that the avoidance of pain is key, is God. And that's how our facade got created. From then on, it's just a natural thing to create a facade, to live in a place that avoids all of that. Yeah, pretty simple, eh? Paul, you'd like to ask?
So our facade's like pretending we're not in pain.
Yep, it's all about pretending. It's all about pretending that it's not there. The pain's not there. The best way to avoid something is pretend it's not there, right? You've ever read Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy? Yeah. What's it called there? It's called How do you become blind to something? Call it somebody else's problem. Yeah. We want to be blind to our own pain, because it's terrifying to consider that we can't experience it, that we don't believe we can cope with it. We don't believe that we're able to. We've been taught from the youngest possible age, it's the very first things we were taught, that we can't deal with it. We were taught it before we could speak. Dave?
So our pain has been made a mountain rather than the molehill that it is. Is that the question? Is that what's happened?
Yeah, well, rather than trying to quantify our pain, because for some people their pain is quite high, you can see that the biggest problem is that the fear of the pain is higher.
Yeah, yeah. To me it seems like we've got this pain, but to experience it, we'll give it an extra prod at the same time.
Yeah, no, it's a terrible thing that's happened here, because it's taught us that of all things that we cannot deal with, pain is the thing we cannot deal with the most.
And it's like we've been cheated out of a lot of things in that process.
Of course we have. Yeah, there's a lot of very damaging behaviour we've even engaged with this belief. It's the one of the most primary false beliefs that exist within us, that we can't deal with pain, that it's impossible to deal with emotional pain, and unwise to. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep. We have so many problems with it, Barbara thinks.
So every part of our facade is hiding a pain.
Yeah, but it's even worse than that, in that the facade is all about, like, this global terror that we have, just preventing ourselves from having to feel anything to do with pain or the terror of pain. So the facade is not only being constructed for each individual thing, but it's being constructed in a global way, in a way that it's like, it's better for me to create a person that everybody else wants me to be than it is to feel my pain about being who I am. Like, that's how we feel. And this is why we've become focused on getting our life just fulfilled through addiction. Because addiction is all about the prevention of the pain. The pain creates these terrible holes in our soul. You could liken them, like, the best way I can describe them to look at them, if you could see your soul, and when you're in the soul union state, you can see this. The best way I could describe it is, like, if you imagine this is a person's soul, which encompasses their bodies. So you've got your spirit body, right, and you've got your physical body, which is all inside your soul. Your soul contains these things. They're like vortexes of energy, like whirlpools. So you, in different areas of your body where there's sort of like a whirlpool, there's just whirlpools everywhere. Every painful emotion that we refuse to feel, there's just whirlpools of energy that sucks different coloured energy from the world into itself. Right? They're your addictions. You can actually see them when you're in the soul union state. You can see the addictions and the colour of them, the energy flowing into them from other people, from the world around you, flows into those locations, because they're like vortexes. They're never-ending vortexes, because nothing that a person can do for you will satisfy them.
So that vortex is, now I'm seeing a bit of the sin of the facade. The vortex is taking.
Always. It's trying to get from the world what is unhealed within itself. So, and when I say the world, it's not just the world that you can see. There's spirits connected at these places. People who feel drawn to that particular injury and supply its need. So we drag around a whole group of spirits with this as well. A lot of the people in our lives, we're dragging around in our lives, connecting to us in this way. They're just supplying what we need, Liam.
So then if you have a spirit filling your vortex, is that then going back the other way to fill their vortex?
Of course, there's got to be some codependency in this.
It's not like there's spirits feeding the spirits or anything like that.
No. Well, you know, that does happen, of course. But no, when there's spirits attached to your body, then there's generally other spirits, you know, there's them supplying your energy, and it's generally you supplying theirs. So it's a codependent addiction.
Trying to stop each other's gaps.
Trying to stop each other's pain. You see, if we didn't have this addiction to stopping each other's pain, it wouldn't happen. But it happens because we're all addicted to stopping everybody's pain, including our own. See? Yeah. So when you see it at the soul level, it's like everywhere in the soul there's these holes, these vortexes like tornadoes going into the soul. And some of them, the more intense they are, the more intense the hole energetically. Like some of them are so big that most people fall into them, you know. Some of our demands are so big. And they're all just because we want to avoid the feeling of what created them, the pain that creates them. Yeah. She's like, we're like great big octopuses with tentacles everywhere, sucking, sticking to everything. What an image, huh? Sucking the life out of everyone around us while they at the same time suck the life out of us. Louise, thanks.
Oh, just a quick question. We have to repent for that spirit attachment that we attract.
Of course.
Yeah.
But that's a part of going through the pain, isn't it? All we need to do is feel the pain and all of a sudden that disconnects. See, if you're unwilling to feel pain, you can't disconnect yourself from spirits. You can't disconnect yourself from spirit influence. You can't disconnect yourself from the influence of others on earth either, unless you're prepared to feel pain. Sooner or later, someone will manipulate your pain, right? Whether it's through bribery or blackmail or threats or actual attack. It's all about, isn't life on earth a lot just about the manipulation of pain? The avoidance of it or manipulating it to get some kind of action. No, you experience this every moment of every day. You turn on the television and you watch an ad, they're just all manipulating your pain. You think about it. How many ads don't manipulate your pain? It's very rare to find one that doesn't manipulate your pain in some way. You turn on telly, oh, this particular car, you know, it's going to make you feel this and it's going to make you feel that. It's just a manipulation of the things you don't feel, right? And then there's a certain food and you've got to have it, or a certain thing, and or you've got to be at a certain place, or there's a certain experience you've got to have, and if you don't have it, you're no good as a person unless you have this particular thing. And you're just getting manipulated every moment because of these vortexes going, I want this, I need this, I need this, I need this. And there's industries out there, billion-dollar industries created just to help you avoid your pain. The whole advertising industry is about that. Creating products that help you avoid something. Now, I'm not saying that all products are bad, because it's certainly not the case, but I'm saying the way that you're manipulated into having them is frequently through these injuries. If we go tomorrow. Thanks.
Is it possible that as a little five-year-old, let's say, my soul or something could have been sucked into these pain vortexes of my mother?
They were. You were. It's not only possible, it's actually the truth. You were.
My soul was sucked in there.
Yeah, yeah.
Wow.
That's why many of you find it so difficult to disconnect from parents, for example. And that's why as soon as you begin the process of disconnecting from parents, what do? They ring you up, they tell you they're not doing the right thing, they do all sorts of things to interfere with the process of disconnecting because they feel the connection. They created it because they needed it. In fact, one of the main reasons on this planet for having a child is to feel one of these holes or more of these holes than just one. That's one of the main reasons for even having a child. How many people want their own child rather than just go and find one of the many millions of children out there that badly need a parent? Why does it have to be their own child? Why? Because of an addiction, because of one of these vortexes. We're all And unfortunately for most of us, not only did we all have it as a child, but as adults, we encouraged it in our own children as well. We did to our children what was done to us. It's full on, eh? It's full on what was done. And you know, so what happens now? Not only was I taught to have all of these vortexes of neediness, if I could call them that, vortexes of neediness to cover over the pain, but now I'm terrified of addressing my pains. So now these vortexes are madly trying to get my pain satisfied through some kind of mechanism, whatever that mechanism, whatever one works. And we don't care about the results even. We just do it. And that's the compulsion. The compulsion to feed these vortexes of pain that we are unwilling to experience through our own choice. So I chose to fear pain. I chose then to use my will, strongly use my will to avoid the experience of pain. And in particular, to strongly use my will to avoid my fear, my terror of pain. See, the problem with pain is that accessing pain is very hard when you've got a layer of terror over the top of it about all of the pain. And you've been experiencing that, right? I've talked to you for years about feeling emotion. For many of you, you haven't yet felt hardly any. So you know that. You know that this is what's going on. You know that there's this terrifying feeling about feeling any of it, right? And we get so hung up about it, and we get so self-destructive about it. When we learn the truth, we tend to punish ourselves for it. But it's just like everybody has it. It's happened to everyone, right? Diana.
So the denial of my fear, for example, and the denial of terror existing within me,
yep.
Is that created and enforced by my parents and by society as well, or is it just something that I have
Of course it's created and enforced by parents and society.
Okay.
But it's also then acceded to by yourself.
Yes, I definitely agree.
Yep. So remember, it's our personal sin that creates most of our pain. But we remember that also society and parents have constructed all of these things within us, and we've accepted the construction. We were children at the time, so you can't punish yourself for that, can you?
No.
Like, it's like why beat yourself over the head for something that every single person on this planet has actually experienced? What I'm talking about is we need to learn how to deconstruct it. But to learn how to deconstruct it, we need to see how it was constructed. Don't we? It's not like a building that you come along with a wrecking ball and just demolish the thing. You've got to know how it's deconstructed. There's a labyrinth in there of all sorts of things going on, causing us to have this layer of terror about pain. And the terror about pain is causing the suppression of the pain and supports the false beliefs. You see, supports a false belief. Then down to Alan, Wendy. We're done. Yep, you first.
Sorry. Okay, so have we got a different set of false beliefs about the terror?
Well, I'm suggesting to you that these false beliefs and false definition of loves relate to your pain.
Yes.
And I'm suggesting you have one primary global emotion about pain generally, and that is, don't feel it. Do everything you possibly can not to feel it, because you're terrified of it. You think a disaster is going to happen if you feel it. You believe it in your heart that it's going to be disastrous for your life. You believe it with all your heart, in fact. Yeah. And that causes you to make a decision. The decision, I need to create a facade to get away from everything here. I need to be a different person than I am. Right? The facade is created from this global refusal of pain, this terror, the refusal to experience the terror relating to pain. It's not the pain itself that you're so afraid of. It's now developed into this terror of terror itself.
Yeah.
And most of you have felt it, right? At some point in time. You've often asked me about it. So most of you have felt it at some point. It is a feeling that most of you have had. So you know it's there. Right? Yeah.
So as a child, I sense quite strongly that I was taken by spirits, and at that point I was taken out of my body.
Mm-hmm.
And I tell myself the story that I had such terror at that point. How do I access that?
Well, can you see that and this is when we're going to talk about this in the middle section a lot, but you can see that the thing we're going to have to do at some point is to experience this terror, isn't it? That's it. We're going to have to experience the terror as an emotion. Yeah.
Just felt so life-threatening.
Well, it feels, that's the thing about terror, it feels life-threatening, but God's truth is that you can't die. Right? It feels, see, this is the thing you've got to recognize about feelings is just because you have a feeling, it doesn't mean it's God's truth. It just means that it's a feeling.
Mm.
And all feelings can be felt, including terror. So if we come down to Alan and then Sam on this side.
If God never created sin, and now we have this global terror issue going on, literally, what's hitting me now is how powerful our souls really are.
We're big creators.
Like he's given us this greatest gift and we've just gone, oh, how far can I trash this? You know what I mean? It's just hitting me emotionally. I'm going, wow, this. I haven't even got to that facade bit yet up there. I'm just looking at that, what that really means, that you can look at that on a micro of what I've done to my son and my daughter or my parents did to me.
Yeah.
But every moment, whether it's television, advertising, driving down the road, the choices we make and the foods we buy, it's all this fear-based mess.
Yeah.
It's pretty fucking scary. Right?
Yeah, yeah. No, it is.
It's just hitting me emotionally. I just wanted to. So if God never created the sin, that means that we could become like gods of the zombie apocalypse. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We can create horror movies after horror movies and God will just watch it.
We do, yeah. We do.
Wow.
That's what we do.
It's just amazing.
Do you think God's enjoying the movie at the moment?
I don't think he watched Netflix or anything like that.
Or the movie of our lives?
No, it's just... So no. I just amazed me that he never created sin, but it's in global proportion. And God and still loves us.
And we created it, yeah. We created it. Amazing creators we are. To the negative or positive, by the way. We've just, most of us have not experienced the positive creation, so we experience the negative by choice. Yeah. Powerful souls. Powerful souls. You remember, you're the most powerful of all of God's creations. Yeah. Sam?
It's a lot of it seems to come back to fear of attack and fear of judgment from others and from society. And
for you?
Yes. Yes, particularly. I'm speaking for myself, I guess.
Yeah. But it does for many too, like not just for you. But you see, what part of it is being quantifiable as fear of attack and what part of it is just, I'm just terrified and I don't really know why? You know, there's a lot of that going on too, where we're just terrified of feeling any emotion, right? The reality is, if we're adults and we live in a private home of our own, having a cry about something is not going to get attacked from somebody else, is it?
No.
But we think it's going to. Because what happened in our childhood? We were attacked.
We were attacked, yeah.
So this is the thing, we've carried on all of these false beliefs about emotion even into our adult life, and then we act on them as if we're still children. And most of us are still children in that regard. We're still acting upon emotions that were created when we were children, and we're now an adult, but we still have the same beliefs as we had when we were a child. We've not changed it, because society and parents and everybody around us is against us changing it anyway. They all don't want us to change it, because if we change it, then they start getting confronted with their fear and their terror of their emotion, and then they start feeling angry about that, and then they, you know, they want to attack.
Yeah.
And this is why we don't want to do anything about it.
So when you're being attacked, you seem to just let yourself kind of soften to that and let that kind of wash over you.
Yeah, I let myself cry. I don't like being attacked, just like you don't, but I'm being attacked. So I let myself cry. I know that eventually you can attack me eventually and I won't cry. Because if I just feel the pain about being attacked every time and just let myself cry and I'm humble to that emotion, eventually all that emotion will leave me, and then when you attack me, I won't cry. But I won't feel bad either. I won't be suppressing anything, because I know that you attacking me has got nothing to do with me.
Yeah, so the pain won't be in you.
So the pain won't be there, yeah.
Yep.
And particularly if I'm loved by God, you can attack me all you want. If I'm loved by God, God's love would overcome, wouldn't it?
Yeah.
All of any of the sadness that might exist.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you.
But yes, we are terrified of attack, but it's not the only terror we have. Many of us are just terrified of experiencing emotion. Many of us are just terrified of experiencing pain for seemingly no reason, but there's always a reason, because you trace it all back and there's always childhood events that caused us to feel this way. But now we have this global emotional refusal of feeling any pain. Once we have that constructed, and most of us had that constructed before we even thought about it, most of us that was constructed, now there's no choice but to create a facade. So what I'm getting at in this conversation with you is that there's things that happened here which created a terror of emotion, a terror of pain, emotional pain. And once that terror of emotional pain was created, from that moment on, the facade was inevitable. Inevitable. Do you understand? There's no other choice but to create one. No other choice available to you but to create one. Deidre?
Hi. Society even has definitions of a good baby and a bad baby, because... Oh, I know I don't want to bring anything personally because it's not that time yet, but...
A good baby is?
Someone that doesn't cry.
Ah.
Because I was thrown
when,
to
when
cry.
What does the child really need to do is get in a barrage of all these terrible emotions. Any child in its right mind would cry.
So that would create terror in itself if a parent wants a good baby, but...
Don't you think the child can feel an emotional threat from a parent? Of course. Of course a child can feel that its very existence is threatened by its own experience of its own emotion.
Because I transferred overnight from a bad baby to a good baby.
Yeah, many children do.
I was thrown across a room.
And then after that you're a good baby.
Yep.
And the parents think that's the best way to get you to be a good baby, throw across the room.
So that would really build my refusal to feel pain and the terror, wouldn't it?
Of course, right from a very young age. This is why for many of you, there is no cognizant reason as to why you're so terrified. You can't intellectually assimilate why you were so terrified. And the main reason why is your terror occurred way before you had an intellect to decide it, to choose it. You follow? Yeah, terrible, huh? Terrible. And then you go punishing yourself for it. It's terrible to punish yourself for something that was an inevitable creation through your experience. There's a difference between taking responsibility for it, recognizing it and deconstructing it, which is something we now need to do, than there is just punishing yourself and, you know, flagellating yourself for having it.
Mm.
Right? And many of you have engaged yourself in that process rather than allowing yourself to just feel what's happened to you. Yeah. It's a very, very destructive process that's happened to each individual on this planet, and it doesn't look like it's going to stop anytime soon. Mm. Which is a worry, right? If we go to Karen on this side and Joy on this side, Yvonne on this side.
And the good baby might grow up to be a good adult because...
Whose definition?
The
whose definition of a good adult?
The world's definition.
Yeah, yeah.
Could that be because the parents project very strongly that they're not allowed to believe that they are bad parents?
And the child's not allowed to believe anything that parents don't want them to believe. Whether it be religious ideas or concepts, concepts about God, concepts about the universe, concepts about science, even a parent generally will not allow the child emotionally to have a concept that the parent itself doesn't understand or gets triggered through fear.
Yeah.
So we have this never-ending cycle of multi-generational sin because no child is allowed to confront the status quo without getting punished further for its sin in society's view of confronting society. You look at every single person on this planet who has ever made a substantial change to the planet itself in terms of bringing it into more harmony with love. Were any of them ever doing so with no opposition? Never. There's not a single record of it happening without opposition. That's why. Intense, eh? This is why we're so terrified. We just have a global terror now of experiencing pain because we know it's going to go against everything. Everybody, everything. Everything has been established in society to avoid it. All right? Yeah. Joy.
I just feel an enormous amount of compassion for all of us.
Yeah. Don't you think our spirit, celestial spirit friends, this is how they feel for you? You know, you block their feelings for you, but this is how they feel for you. They feel this compassion. They've experienced it themselves. They know how much work they've had to do to get out of that state. They also know, unfortunately, that it could be completely different. For each one of us, it could be completely different. We could have a much better childhood and a much better growing experience than we currently have had. And isn't it sad that if we make different choices for the next generation, they could have a much better experience? Yeah.
Why have I never felt compassion like this before?
Because you haven't understood the creation of your facade. You haven't understood. See, this is a beautiful thing about truth. Is that truth actually allows you to be relieved of all of this sort of judgment and other things that cause you to feel bad about yourself. Truth allows you to just see it as it is, and it's actually relieving to see it as it is.
It seems ludicrous that we would judge ourselves and be so hard on ourselves.
Yeah.
For something.
For something that.
Like this.
Yeah, it's just intense, eh? Yeah. Now, can I just proceed a little further now with the discussion? Because we need to now see that, okay, I was taught to do this. Now I have the motivation inside of me, my terror inside of me motivates me to do it, to deny my pain, my terror. And now I'm even in a state where I feel terrified every single day of my life, right? The average person on earth does. And now I've got to learn how to suppress this terror somehow. I've got to. So what do I do with it? What do I do? Well, I create techniques. To avoid terror. That's what I do. And as you've seen, we are powerful in our creations. We're remarkable in how far we can go in denial of things. Like, we deny that 100 million children die every year, right? Through malnutrition or abortion, there's 100 million children dying every year. We're okay with it. We are okay with it because we just make out it's not there to ourselves. Or we say to ourselves, we can't do anything about it. And it's fixed. We don't have to face the emotion of it anymore, right? So what are the techniques? Well, we introduced you to the techniques last week. What were those techniques? Can you remember? Denial, lies, excuses, blame, justify, minimize, abuse, attack, whatever, yeah, judge, and the list goes on, does it not? All right, that's what we do. They are our techniques. They are our primary techniques to avoid the terror itself. We deny we're terrified. So the majority of you deny you're terrified by using lots of different techniques. Why do you think many of us are addicted to coffee in the morning? If you could actually feel what coffee does to your body, it heightens, ironically, it heightens the experience of terror. Yeah. And you don't even feel it. You're suppressing things so strongly, you use it to suppress terror. Ironic. If I have a coffee, I can't sleep for 4 days. It's terrible. I'm kind of like this, shaky, can't think, can't do anything for 4 days. So I don't have coffee, as you can gather. All right. But what else do we do? We do things like we take suppressants or we take what we call pick-me-ups, right? And pick-me-ups are food as well as, like, those substances besides just drugs. They're substances, the other substances that are acceptable in society. Why do you think most of us numb out for a bit in front of the telly? Why do you think we do a lot of the things we do? It's because we've just got so many techniques to avoid terror, avoid the experience of pain. It's all about avoiding, right? Now, we've got to see ourselves as responsible for this, but we've also got to see, we've got to cut ourselves some slack in the sense of the fact that it's there and it's been created by a whole set of experiences in our childhood. And the reality is the majority of you would not even have survived your own childhood unless you did it. You'd be emotional vegetables now if you hadn't have done what you did. If not dead. And that's how serious it is. And you're going to feel that once you start connecting to some of the pain. You're going to feel the imperative, what drove the feelings to do these things. So we have these techniques, and these techniques, we use them to prevent the truth about our pain. We use them to prevent our own acknowledgement of even our own terror of our pain. And now we've got all these vortexes of emotion that need satisfaction. Not only do they need satisfaction, they demand satisfaction. They become our lifelong goal, and that's what we want to achieve now, the satisfaction of each specific individual emotion. So, for example, we feel unsafe, so we marry someone who makes us feel safe. We don't care whether we love the person or not. It's just whether they make us feel safe, and we go, that's love. That's love. A person who makes me feel safe loves me. And so that's what we do. And then, who do we have sex with? Well, that doesn't necessarily mean it's the person that we just married, because that person may not give us the other vortex of emotion, which is give me approval, give me sexual validation, give me some, feelings that you really want me. And that if my person who makes me feel safe doesn't do that, then I'll go and get that from someone else. And then if both of those persons don't do that, then maybe mummy will do it or daddy will do it for me. And if they don't do it, then maybe I just need a friend who will do it for me. They'll help me feel the particular thing that the rest of them can't do it. And so I finish up surrounding myself with 25 different friends, all who have a different role to fill one of my vortexes. And I call them friends. I call them the other people I love. And then when all that doesn't work and I haven't found any person to do that, now I start to look at substances instead. So whether that be a drug that's a pharmaceutical, if a doctor will give me one, well, that's better than anything because it's approved, right? It's approved by everybody. Everyone lets me get away with that drug. But if that's not there, then let's go out and have some dope or let's go out and have some speed, depending on whether we need to be picked up or suppressed. What do we want? Like, we're just a vortex of preventative, we're just preventing specific emotions using these addictions now. So now we're up here, frantically trying to get, like a dog chasing his tail, frantically trying to get every single one of these emotional vortexes fulfilled. And when somebody doesn't fulfill them, whoa. They're not nice people, right? We'll even justify the murder of a person who doesn't fulfill one of our vortexes. Many of you ladies have had an abortion just for that reason. Well, hey. Pretty intense, huh? Pretty intense. So there we are. We've developed and maintained our techniques. We now use these techniques to deny the pain, but now we're using them to construct the facade. So now the facade is actively being experienced. It's in fact an imperative that we do it that way, because the facade is the thing that gets us everything we want from the world. Whereas this does not. Nobody wants to know our pain. Isn't that the truth? Like, you try and sit down and have a conversation with somebody about your pain and see how long the conversation lasts. But you sit down and have a conversation about your addictions and that can go on for days. Right? Yeah. Yeah, it's pretty intense, huh? There's the creation of our facade. Right, and can you see already that we have to get to a stage where we see that we need to start loving ourselves a bit more about it? rather than sort of punishing ourselves for having it. Right. Yeah. It's a terrible thing that's happened, but it's multi-generational. It's been happening for centuries on this planet, millennia, in fact. And any person who's attempted to be brave enough to break the paradigm has usually died a violent death. Even right to the modern era, this century just gone. There's many people who have attempted to break the paradigm, and most of them have died violently. That shows you how invested the world is in maintaining this terror-based prevention of pain. Yep. So it's no wonder that we have the problems we have accessing our painful emotions, isn't it? You see? Yep. Rick, thanks.
So the facade, is that basically the sum of all your addictions?
Yes, you could say it is. Actually, the sum of all your addictions, yeah. Yeah. Yeah, you could.
Thank you.
Yeah, good question. Yep. Could make some movies about that. The sum of all addictions. Instead of the sum of all fears, as there's one movie called. Yeah. It's interesting, isn't it, how we just tolerate this, you know, like, it's like this. It's like most of us know it's like this too, really. We still tolerate it. Yes, thanks. Janice.
AJ, in your time in the first century, was it worse or better? Or the same?
Much the same. I think nowadays it's a lot easier, Janice, to actually meet your addictions, meet your facade. Back then, life was a lot harsher, and so it was harder to get all of your addictions met. Mm. Nowadays, it's so easy to get more of your addictions met. Mm. It really is. It's like terrifyingly easy. Mm. Like if you look at the average child growing up in Western society now, almost every single one of their addictions is met.
Yeah.
So it doesn't... It's not going to go well for the next generation, because it's just we're just meeting the addictions of all of our children generally. Yeah.
Does that mean war?
Well, it's going to mean a lot of turmoil of all kinds. Mm. Yeah, of all kinds. Yeah, it's rare to see a child nowadays whose addictions are not being met. Mm. Yeah, very rare in the Western world.
Mm. Mm. Thank you.
Mm. So in some ways we've improved in life. Obviously, you know, the lot of women has improved over 2,000 years compared to our first century time. First century was a lot more violent than the average thing on the planet, violent level on the planet is now. But that all being said, we also meet our addictions much more powerfully, which means when that's confronted, we'll get much more angry than we ever have before. So it's hard to compare things, you know, situations like this, but yeah, I feel that unless there's a generation of people who choose to do what you're choosing to do, and that is to start educating themselves about how this occurred and what to do about it, there's not much hope for subsequent generations. Mm. Yeah. Kel, thanks.
Have we used your death in the first century as an excuse to not feel our terror from what happened to you?
I feel it's used as an excuse for many things, yeah. Basically, you now believe, majority of you now believe that if you're a good person, that bad things are going to happen to you. It's a fairly strong belief if you think about it. Like, no good deed goes unpunished, as the saying is, isn't it? This is, and in some regards, it's actually a truth on this planet. It's not God's truth, but it is on this planet the way we are, isn't it? We do have a tendency as humanity to punish people who are doing good. They expose within us so many things that we are not willing to experience in terms of our own examination of ourselves, that we'd rather kill them than examine ourselves. Yeah. So there is a need, but obviously the fact that you know, people could return to speak of these truths with you is an indication that God feels that there's potential in the other direction. And I do feel there are a lot of people nowadays who want to understand more why pain exists and what, you know, what the cause of it is. So that's good too. So I would say that we are at a decision point as humanity. We're at a decision point. Are we going to decide to keep going along with the flow? The flow that's always gone on? Or are we going to start swimming against the current and start changing? And it is like that. You'll find it's like that. You'll feel like that at times, like you're swimming against the current. But remember, it's not God's current that you're swimming against. It's the current of humanity's avoidance of pain. If we're prepared to feel pain, we can grow substantially. It also means that we can be educated by God, because all of the things that oppose the education can be released. It's a very key thing that we need to address. So do you understand a bit better how your facade got created? And can you start to see the reason for feeling a bit better about it than you have been? Yeah? Having a bit more compassion for yourselves about it. Right? Because honestly, without this compassion for your facade, you're not going to accept it. Not going to accept it. You're going to keep denying it, keep denying it, keep suppressing it, keep making out that it's your real you, and it's not. Yeah. So what we've hoped to have achieved in this conversation with you is to help you see a number of things. Firstly, that having pain and false beliefs is one thing. It's one area that we need to address. Obviously, once the pain and false beliefs are released from us, basically we have the option after that to become perfect. When I say the option, it's still a choice, isn't it? Still a choice. It's a decision we're going to need to make, but it's going to be a much easier decision to make, obviously. But because we have this suppression of pain, this terror of it, this feeling of terror about pain, which has been inculcated, trained in us from such a young age, and there's been the threat of violence associated with the inculcation, the teaching of the suppression of pain. For millennia, every single person who's ever attempted to release pain has always been attacked. Right? And this is why we're so terrified of it, one of the reasons why. We have this global terror of it. Terrified. We're even terrified of the emotion itself of terror. We feel that it's an impossible emotion to feel. That's what we believe. And because of that, these vortexes of pain need to be satisfied somehow, either through release or through the satisfaction from external means. And so now what we're doing is we're now addicted to satisfying these vortexes, these holes in our soul, through external means. And there's our facade. There's the creation of our facade. Many of us learnt to do this before we could even think straight. Right? And the reason why was because it was our very survival depended on it. As a child, our very survival depended upon us creating a facade for the sake of parents and the society around us. Our survival depended on it. And that's why we have so much terror associated with it. It's a survival instinct, as the saying goes. Or I would classify it as a survival terror, a feeling that we're going to die if we don't do it, a feeling that the worst thing could happen, worse than death, will happen if we don't do it. And this is why I can say to you thousands of times there's no such thing as death, and you won't hear it here. Because there's the terror that's stopping us from hearing anything that's good. So what do you think is going to have to come out of us in order to receive some of God's education? Can you see? It's pretty obvious, isn't it? This terror is going to have to come out of us. And the only way any emotion can come out of us is by feeling it. So every one of us is going to have to go through a terror-based experience. And we don't want to. We've been doing everything we possibly can to avoid it. We've been taught to avoid it at the threat of death. Hence the creation of our facade. Okay. All right, well, what we'll do now is have a 10-minute break. And if we come back about, 25 to 4, and then we'll do some Q&A about this subject.